This is the North Carolina Department of Transportation Erosion and Sediment Control Certification Training for Level 2. This module will cover soil erosion and sediment transport. Your presenter is Rich McLaughlin, professor in the Department of Crop and Soil Sciences at North Carolina State University. Soil erosion happens in two phases. First, the particles have to become detached from the soil mass. This can be done by raindrops, flowing water, or even wind. Next, these particles have to be transported down the slope or with the wind. Note that a lot of soil gets transported in rills and gullies. These photos illustrate the two steps. You can see the raindrops impacting the soil, creating craters and splashing soil particles all over the place. You can also see on the right the massive soil transport as runoff exits a construction site. There are five factors in soil losses. First, the type of rain that occurs is very important. How intense it is, how long it lasts, and the raindrop energy. Intense summer thunderstorms with lots of wind can be highly erosive, for example. Second, the soil properties also affect the erosion rates, such as texture or particle sizes, structure, and organic matter content. Note that most construction site soils have low organic matter, so this is not really a helpful factor. Thirdly, obviously, the slope length and steepness are both going to play a major role in erosion rates, with longer or steeper slopes being worse. Surface conditions are also very important, such as the presence of vegetation or mulch, which can be able to reduce erosion by 90%. Finally, the practices we put in place also can reduce erosion, such as silt fences, slope drains, sediment basins, check dams, and others. We'll be going over all of these in a later module. In order for runoff to get started, the soil first has to become saturated so that it cannot soak up the rain that is falling. How fast this occurs can depend on the soil that you're dealing with. Here we have a chart showing how fast rain can soak into or infiltrate soils with different textures. Sandy soils at the top in the red line can soak up a lot of rain, while clay soils down at the bottom in the green line cannot. Notice how the rain, as it continues, will have all of the soils soaking up even less water. So long duration storms can generate a lot of runoff. Back to our rain splash picture, showing that the soil is saturated with puddles forming and runoff will start happening. If you look at this picture, what should come to mind is how could I prevent this? And in most cases, a ground cover is what you should be thinking about. Soil properties also affect how fast erosion occurs. We think of soil as having three sizes of particles: sand, silt, and clay, from largest to smallest. Soils with lots of silt tend to erode easily, while those with lots of clay do not, because the clay particles tend to stick to each other and everything else. Sand infiltrates water very quickly, as we saw, so it is less likely to erode. But if it does, it also does not go very far because of the large particle size. Organic matter reduces erosion, but as we mentioned earlier, little organic matter exists in the subsoil materials that are usually being moved around on construction sites. This is an illustration of how a raindrop can erode soil simply from its impact. It forms a crater, then it throws the particles out, and these can then be picked up by flowing water. On a slope, the soil being thrown out of the crater actually goes farther down the slope. And so actually you get erosion just from the raindrops pushing the soil down the slope. as we discussed earlier, when the soil becomes saturated, the water starts to flow downhill. Obviously, initially, this is spread out in sheet flow, which mainly just carries particles detached by the raindrops. As we will repeat throughout this training, covering the soil is very effective because it stops raindrop detachment and slows sheet flow. This picture shows how raindrops and sheet flow can erode the soil over time. Notice all the rocks on the surface? They didn't fall out of the sky, but instead, the soil around them eroded away. Our ancestors used to send the whole family out to the crop fields at the end of the season to pick up all the rocks so the spring plowing could be done. This was an indication of how much erosion was happening before we started using better farming practices. While we start with sheet flow, the runoff will quickly collect into rills, which generally get deeper downslope due to high water flows. The rill not only carries raindrop detached soil, but it also erodes the soil itself. This is a great example of rills on a long, steep slope. You can see that they get deeper, and notice the deposits at the bottom of the slope. Can you guess what soil particles are left there? Yes, the sand is what drops out soon after the water slows a little bit by the ditch. Can you think of any way to prevent this erosion? One option would be interrupt the flow in the middle of the channel, perhaps by installing a bench that would take the flow off to the side. So that would be right across here. Rills that are unattended often become gullies. What's the difference? One way to separate rills from gullies is the truck test. If you can't drive a truck across it, it's a gully. Gullies often get started when there is a slight dip in the slope, which starts a small waterfall. The head wall of the waterfall tends to move up slope unless it runs into a root or a pipe or other obstacle. The picture on the upper left is a rill on its way to becoming a gully. On the lower right is a gully that has made it to the top of the slope. You can see the process that is occurring. On the left side, right here, a waterfall has scoured the headwall and it will collapse soon. On the right, over here, the headwall actually has collapsed and the waterfall will wash all that away and start the process over. Tremendous amounts of sediment can be generated by gullies, so they should never be seen on your project. How would you prevent these from happening? The key is to find a way to get the water at the top of the slope down to the bottom without eroding the slope. We'll discuss how to do that in the section on best management practices, but you can be thinking about it in the meantime. As a reminder, ground covers are used to stop what from happening? Of these, detachment is the best answer. Something called the universal soil loss equation was developed to help people predict how much erosion might occur, mostly in crop fields. We won't be doing any calculations, but if you look at what goes into the calculations, you can see all the factors we've discussed. Rainfall, soil erodibility, slope, gradient, the cover, and then any practices that we might want to install. Here are some examples of erosion rates in different situations. A nice healthy lawn will generate very little sediment, while fields managed in different ways will generate more depending on the management. In contrast, look at the last two bars and see how much erosion occurs when the soil is bare, like it is for periods of time on construction sites. That is why we have this training. The potential damage to our waterways is quite high if we don't manage the sediment. Poorly managed construction sites can generate problems on adjacent roadways, as you can see. Here we have a slope with an overwhelmed silt fence, and here we have a silt fence that wasn't doing very good at all. Construction-related erosion can damage property, and off-site movement can cause a lot of problems. Sediment getting into storm drains is a big problem, both because it clogs the pipes, but also because that sediment is likely heading towards a stream. If an inspector sees this, the contractor will have to find a way to get the sediment out of the pipes. Very difficult and very expensive. Sediment leaving a construction site can end up in wetlands, as you see on the left, or it may likely be heading towards a stream, as you see on the right. If an inspector sees this, the contractor will have to find a way to get the sediment out of the pipes, out of the wetlands and out of the streams using buckets and no equipment. This is also going to be quite expensive. There are many ways that sediment negatively impacts waterways, as you see in this bullet list. On the upper right, that's a trout stream that had a tremendous load of sediment from a failure on a construction site. That contractor had to pay $1 million fine plus send people into the stream with vacuums to actually remove the sediment from between the stones. All right, last quiz. What practice did we discuss that reduces erosion by 90%? Hopefully everybody got mulch and ground covers. That is the end of this module.